Hello, Melbourne, from Nidri to Nepean Highway, from Hastings to Hartwell. This is Mansfields Melbourne, your nightly half-hour look at the best of everything in town. It's Footy Tips Night, of course, it's the best of what's on, and a couple of interesting people for you to meet. Friday, June the 19th is our night together, just before round 13 of football. I'll be here with my tips later on in the program. A special treat tonight as we talk to a World War II veteran who served in the tropics during World War II. And that's a preview of our special Tropical North Queensland treat tomorrow night at 6 on Mansfields Melbourne, where we take the cameras from Channel 31 all over Tropical Far North Queensland, and you're just going to love it tomorrow night at 6. But we talk to a veteran from Far North Queensland a little later tonight. In the meantime, here's news for you. The Dandenong Northman is willing to offer a reward of up to $1,000 for the return of a missing family pet. Our Fairfax News affiliate, the Dandenong Journal, says that Lance Miles has visited every dog pound from the Mornington Peninsula to Burwood since two-year-old Jake went missing early this month. The Red Heeler escaped when Mr. Miles took the dog to his business in Dandenong South. Householders out in Maroondah can expect to pay $18 extra in rates next financial year. Our news affiliate, Maroondah Post Newspaper, says there might also be another $4 for garbage collections as the council decides on its new charges for the 1998-1999 year. Commercial and industrial changes are likely to rise even further. Monash Municipality is not being overrun by rates, according to the council's Greg Axford. Widespread talk of rat plague. I may have said rates, should not be in there. Rats are not plaguing Monash. Widespread talk of a rat plague is unfolded by Mr. Axford in the Monash Post newspaper, although there is acknowledgement that there's a number of complaints about rats that have been made in the Clayton area. The council is introducing a free rat bait program. I used to have that problem, but you can buy a little device that sends out an ear-piercing shriek into the rat's ear, and they never come to the rat. Thanks very much, Pearl. Thank you. This is detailed. I didn't think we had it in the office of the Danos powerful pest protection available. See, that's the... they're about the size of... a bit bigger than... about a cigarette pack. And it emits this ear-piercing squeal to the rat, to the bug, to the bee, to the insect, to the cockroach, and they run for miles. You leave it going and it will cleanse the house totally in a matter of 2 weeks.
Bruce, have you got a pest control?
No, I had... I have, yes, I beg your pardon. I don't have a pest problem now because I use it at a holiday destination that I use. And not that I've ever seen great rats and mice, but Danos is very good, $39, from $39...
They got a phone number?
Yeah, I'll give you their number. Don't say that. Are you meaning me, are you? 1800-808-938. Danos, by direct. Finally, this Friday, construction of a new $100 million golf course at Roville is set to go by the end of the year. Waterford Valley will house an 18-hole golf course, 4-star hotel, and 3 retirement villages. A 300-seat restaurant will also be included in the project. Well, if you'd like to defrost yourself in Far North Queensland, Qantas has got some great getaway deals from July to mid-September, right in the coldest months here in Melbourne. Have a listen to these Qantas, defrosting bargains. Stay at Holiday Inn Cairns for 4 nights from $790. You couldn't do better than that.
Did you like that place?
I did. I liked the owner too. Peter, I think his name was. Or the manager. 3 nights at Marlin Waters.
Lovely lady in yellow.
$784. That's Marlin Waters, $784. That's 3 nights. And I've seen these places. They are palaces. The Sheraton Mirage Port Douglas. 3 nights from $1,045. That's 3 nights. That's including airfare.
How much?
3 nights. For $1,045. That's Sheraton. That's world class. 5-star. Ridges Club Tropical. 3 nights from $874 with full, and I'm repeating, full buffet breakfasts. And the Port Douglas Retreat. 3 nights from $775. Prices are twin share, yeah, and conditions apply, yeah, but get me there. See reservations and contact reservations at your travel agent or the Qantas Travel Centre, or call Qantas on Far North Queensland. Don't freeze down here. Cut a couple of days. Cut a weekend or a week. Spend it in Far North Queensland. There's Qantas's number, 13, 14, 15. Good number, easy to remember. 13, 14, 15, Qantas for those defrosting bargains. Back soon.
Then, on February 19, 1937, the Airlines of Australia, Stinson, City of Brisbane, left Brisbane at 1:30 in the afternoon on a regular flight to Sydney with five passengers and a crew of two on board. It never arrived, having crashed into the McPherson Range near the Queensland-New South Wales border. Incredibly, three men survived the crash, but they found themselves in a desperate situation, facing death from hunger and exposure. One of them set off into the bush to seek help, but fell to his death down a waterfall. It took the determination of a young bushman named Bernard O'Reilly, who after more than a week of searching in the remote wilderness, found the mangled aircraft and the two remaining survivors, Binstead and Proud.
I heard the reports from the Hawkesbury area had been contradicted, and as the McPherson Range is the most dangerous flying country between Brisbane and Sydney, I naturally thought to look there. Well, when I came within, say, 25 yards of the plane through the jungle, I saw the top chopped off a tree, and then I saw another tree all charred with flames. And then I saw the very top of the flame, one crippled wing.
Yes?
And immediately after, the two men called out to me.
In what condition did you find the survivors?
I found them in very good heart, but looking very bad. I didn't tell them that. But one chappie was writing his last message on a sheet of metal, and within 5 minutes he was asking me what the cricket score was. I wasted no time in whipping up a bit of brandy and egg and pouring it down the mouths of these two chappies.
In what kind of country did the plane crash?
Probably the worst on earth. Straight up and down mountain stuff, about 3,000 feet high, sheer cliffs on either side, and dense lawyer vine jungle.
Well, then you found the men, and I understand you made them comfortable.
As comfortable as possible under the circumstances, which means that I gave them what little bit of bread and butter I had left, and I made them a little drop of tea. And I think I gave Mr. Binstead my jacket. I dashed off then for help, picking out about half a dozen men whom I knew to be very reliable. We got the doctor and a few supplies and rushed back up the gorge to get back to these men.
Through the cold and mist, rescuers struggled with the stretchers on which the two survivors were carried. Working in 15-minute shifts, the 80 men toiled through the rugged mountains to bring Binstead and Proud back to civilization, where an ambulance was waiting to take them to hospital. Endurance and courage beyond belief, and a classic story of survival. Commercial aviation during World War II was virtually non-existent, but it soon became apparent that supremacy in the air was essential for victory. And by 1943, the Allies were rapidly gaining the lead. Australia's newly formed aircraft industry was turning out bow fighters, a high-speed aircraft with heavy firepower. But as with all types of planes, there were training mishaps. Watch closely as the newsreel cameraman captures this spectacular accident as two bow fighters collide during a flypast over the sea off Jervis Bay. Both crews were killed in the tragedy, and the film was censored and not seen publicly until after the war. On March 10, 1946, an ANA Douglas DC-3 left Hobart on a flight to Melbourne with 21 passengers and a crew of four on board. Just after takeoff, the plane crashed into the sea off 7 Mile Beach. The aircraft came down a few hundred metres from shore, and there were no survivors. It was the worst disaster in the history of Australian commercial aviation to that time. ANA was to suffer another blow to its safety record in 1948 when on September 2, their DC-3 Lutana took off from Brisbane at 5:30 p.m. on what was expected to be a normal flight to Sydney with 10 passengers and 3 crew aboard. At 7.53, it radioed Sydney Control that it was flying over Williamtown at 1,800 metres and was given permission to come down to 1,200. The plane was due in Sydney at 8.40, but it did not arrive. As airport control desperately tried to regain contact, all planes flying north were asked to keep a lookout, but Lutana had vanished. Search planes were in the air at dawn the next day, flying a triangular search area mapped out west and south of Williamtown. The search was extended to sea, following reports from a collier that a plane was flying low over the water. The trained air crews scoured the sea and the coastline all day, but there was no sign of Lutana. At the time Lutana reported itself over Williamtown, it was in fact more than 160 kilometres to the northwest near Quirindi, where within 20 minutes after its last message, it crashed into a mountainside. As the organised search had failed to find any trace of the Lutana, Captain J.C. Patterson, an East-West Airlines pilot flying from Tamworth to Sydney, followed a hunch that Lutana might have been off course and crashed into Barrington Tops. So he flew east of his normal course and found the missing aircraft. It had crashed into the side of the highest mountain in the area, which was uncharted on aviation maps. Rescuers found it tough going scaling the 1,400-metre mountain. The country was rough, and it was an 8-kilometre climb from the foot. They arrived at the crash scene to find that Lutana had completely disintegrated on impact. It had hit the mountain at 240 kilometres an hour and burst into flames, killing all on board instantly. As the grim procession began down the mountainside with the bodies of the passengers and crew, questions began to be asked. Why was the pilot so far off his course? And why was the 1,400-metre mountain uncharted on civil aviation maps? The Prime Minister ordered a full open inquiry into the disaster, and a special newsreel item was produced in an attempt to re-establish confidence in a public that was starting to question the safety of flying.
The Lutana disaster throws the spotlight on safety in flying. In these exclusive pictures, CineSound takes you behind the scenes to show just what measures are taken by civil aviation control of flying to protect the travelling public. Weather information is all important. Teleprinter reports come into Kingsford Smith Control Tower and are transferred by meteorological officers to detailed weather maps. Every 3 hours, a new map is drawn. Here is shown temperature, humidity, and other weather conditions at heights of 5, 10, and 18,000 feet. A falling barometer means as much to the pilot as it does to the seaman. Serviceability of all airfields and navigation aids is shown to pilots on this board. Coloured discs indicate the condition of all airfields, including emergency fields, on his route. Nothing is left to chance. The pilot makes out his flight plan, stating his proposed course, speed, and altitude. The flight checking officer studies it, gives him a clearance. Check and double check. The plane is serviced, the crew briefed, it's time for takeoff.
Yeah, from Terry Able Dog. Am I clear to taxi out for takeoff, please? Over.
Terry Able Dog, clear for takeoff, over.
Let's follow this plane from Sydney to Brisbane, flying the same path in reverse the Lutana should have taken. Heading north, clear of the airport, the pilot is directed by approach control radio for the first 60 miles, and he soon lets his automatic pilot take over.
Sydney Radio, this is Terry Able Dog. My position is Thermo 1130, in cloud 10,000.
Now air traffic control has him under its wing, and the pilot radios his position, altitude, and weather. His report is received in the control room and is checked on the radonescope. This quick, easy, and accurate method of estimating a plane's position, speed, and height is now used throughout the world. It was invented by an Australian, Mr. Norman Rodoni. As soon as the pilot's report is checked, the plane's position is changed on the air traffic board. This, together with a Rodoni scope, traces the movement of every aircraft leaving Sydney and keeps their position constantly under review. Estimated times of arrival are chalked on the flight information board, as control officers in the radio room receive information of position and speed. The radio beam literally guides this plane north, and here's how the system works. The beam provides a continuous radio path for the plane to follow. It's 5 miles wide at its extremity, getting narrower near the transmitting station. The pilot is center on his course when he hears a continuous radio signal. If he veers to seaward, he gets a continuous dot warning. On the landward side, an interrupted dash warning. It is obvious the Lutana could not have been flying on this beam when she crashed. Now Brisbane approach takes over, issuing instructions, late weather information, and any other reports the pilot may need. The eyes and ears of radio are guiding him to his destination. It's getting dark, but flying by instruments presents no problems. At the airfield, radar plots the plane's course to the runway long before the aircraft itself is sighted. The moving dot is the actual plane. And there's Brisbane. Another routine flight completed without incident. Another crowd of passengers and freight flown in safety. Skilled pilots, modern aircraft, scientific instruments, radio and radar. These are the weapons fighting for safety along Australia's commercial air lanes.
You've enjoyed the television program, now read the magazine, Mansfield's Melbourne magazine. The May issue is 112 pages packed with articles from Channel 31 viewers. Win a trip to London, win a defensive driving course, win great prizes. Mansfield's Melbourne magazine, four magazines for the price of one. The latest in show business news in TV Radio Confidential, a 20-page Nightlines feature, and a special lift-out on the history of Melbourne radio. Mansfield's Melbourne magazine, just $2 at your local newsagent, out now. Saba Furniture, where there's hundreds of lounge suites in stock. You'll save hundreds of dollars on recliner suites, leather suites, and occasional furniture. You'll save 30% on sofas and sofa beds. And there's free delivery too. Call and say hello to Joe and Maureen at Saba. See Saba Furniture's Superstore at 802 Burwood Highway, Ferntree Gully. They're open 7 days a week and no reasonable offer will be refused. There's easy parking too at Saba Furniture, Ferntree Gully. You can call 97588200, 97588200 at Saba, 802 Burwood Highway, Ferntree Gully. And remember, no reasonable offer will be refused.
You know, it's well and good to come up to places like Cairns in far north tropical Queensland, but it's terrific to find out a little bit of the history and the colour from some of the colourful people around the place. And have you lived up here all your life?
No, I've only been here during the war years.
What's your name?
Martin.
Martin, is it?
Marnie. M-A-H-O-N-Y.
And just your first name?
Jack.
Jack, were you stationed here during the war?
I was stationed in Cairns.
In Cairns?
Yes.
Tell us what the township of Cairns was like in those times.
Well, it's about a quarter the size that it is now. And when I came back here now, after 50-odd years, they turned the place around. Yeah. I get bushed.
Yeah. And for the better?
Well, possibly, but it looks as though it got too big for itself at the present time.
Well, what was the road between Cairns and where we are, Port Douglas, during the war years? Was that, were we a threat from the enemy?
Well, once the Battle of the Coral Sea was over, well, there was no threat then,
well,
because the Japs, up until then, well, the danger was there.
But were the Japanese looking toward here?
They were coming down here and we went to war to keep them out. And when you come up here now and see as many as there is wandering around, we wonder whether we did the right thing or not.
Well, I think we did the right thing. They're, you know, peaceful people now, but it was different in the, 50 years ago. So the battlement, took place right along the coast?
No, the battles were mostly overseas.
Yes.
But they did drop a bomb or two here, and they let a few torpedoes go. That's down the coastal strip.
And, of course, as well in Darwin, they were pretty well bombarded,
weren't
they?
They were certainly bombarded over there, yes.
Were you in the Air Force at the time?
No, I was in the Army.
Yeah.
I was a special branch in the Army.
Did you go overseas or you stayed here?
I went overseas.
Where would you go?
I went to Moratai. That was on the way to Borneo.
All right, well, you've seen a lot as well as progress in the area, and thanks for talking to us about the old times in far north Queensland. Friday night in Melbourne, and let's look at round 13 footy for this weekend. Tonight, Essendon will beat West Coast at the MCG. Pompous swine I am. Who knows what they'll do, but that's what I think. Tomorrow, Collingwood will beat Adelaide at the MCG. It's the first Saturday game. Geelong will defeat Brisbane Lions at Cadinia Park. North Melbourne will be better than Hawthorn at Waverley. And I'll bet the crowd at Waverley embarrasses at AFL yet again. And the Western Bulldogs will score the 4 points over Port Adelaide. On Sunday, St Kilda might just beat the Demons at MCG. Sydney will probably be just done by Richmond at the SCG. And Fremantle will likely to score another home ground loss to the Blues. Yep, good news for you Carlton fans, I feel, from my crystal ball. That's it for another night in our city. Today, Friday, June the 19th, the birthday of a woman who created a royal scandal today, the Duchess of Windsor, born in 1896 and married King Edward VIII, who abdicated from the throne. Did he become king?
Yes, he did. King, so he
yeah, true. Yes, stupid. Stupid, ridiculous comment and illiterate on my part. The birthday of band leader Guy Lombardo, the renowned band leader of the 40s and 50s. And Pearl, what... Pardon me. I think that's Guy now. What piece of music is Guy Lombardo most noted for? His famous piece.
Tommy Kangaroo Dance?
No, Auld Lang Syne. He plays it at the Waldorf Astoria every New Year's Eve and has done so for 50 years.
Well, he didn't make it.
Stay tuned to Channel Neither of You. Stay tuned to Channel 31 for a great night of Kabiyoto Te Fioing. And I'll be next on radio with an nostalgia programme, Remember When, with Simon Owens on Sunday night from 9 on 3AW. And be with us tomorrow night at 6 for a real treat. I'm looking forward to this. We're leaving the frosty conditions of Melbourne and travelling to far north Queensland, showing you some of the great people and resorts and residential accommodation up there. Oh, and before I go, I'd love to meet up with you tomorrow, Saturday at 12 noon at BBC Home Hardware House in Moorabbin. Plenty of prizes to be won there on the corner of Warrigal Road and Fairchild Street in Moorabbin. And that's it for this part of Friday. Good night from me, and good night to Mike McColl Jones.
Well, that's another night in our city. A Greek Orthodox church in Red Hill says it's been subject to racist taunts and religious persecution during its ongoing battle with Mornington Peninsula Council to renovate a shed on the church grounds. Church pastor Florios Tsitsasos.
Oh, no, treat it seriously. He's a pastor of the church.
I know he is. His name...
Let's go do it properly.
Eld...
Aled, F.
Aled Flitfatos Tsitsasos says he's received faxes with swastikas and the words no wogs in a reference to One Nation. Father Tsatsos says the church has had 7 vandalism attacks over the past month.
An accident at the City Link website on the Tullamarine Freeway caused a power blackout to almost 2,000 properties in Pasco Vale, with a worker striking a pole that had a cable head on it.
Funny thing to find a worker with a cable head. Anyway, that's it for another night in our city, Ash. This is the day of 1996 when singer James... Pardon me. Oh, dear me, that is hysterical. The day in 1996 when singer Jade Hurley broke his wrist. Pardon me. I know Jade and I know what happened. He broke his wrist and shoulder after falling from the roof of his Tweed Valley home while chasing a bungee. Oh, dear. I'm sorry.
Take a
quickies.
Poor old Jade.
Oh, I went touring with Jade.
Ding, with ding, ding.
Give me that ding.
Give me that ding. Give me that ding, ding, ding.
Oh, dear. Dear old Jade. Sorry about that, Jade, but it happened a long time ago. Oh, no, only last year.
It's good night for the moment, but we'll be back with more in just a moment from Martin Pitt Real Estate. Why? Why?
Thank you.